Then fear came upon all their neighbors, and all these matters were discussed throughout the hill country of Judea. All who have heard these things took them to heart, saying, "What then will this child be? For surely the hand of the Lord was with him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Sisters and brothers, somebody someday should go through the entire Gospel of Luke and count how many times the word mercy is used. It would be very interesting mathematical study. I myself have not done it, so I don't know. But the word mercy does occur frequently in the Gospel of St. Luke. In fact, did you hear the opening prayer of Mass tonight? That somehow, as Jesus comes among us, mercy is being poured forth. Now, we say this because Pope Francis has just called us to a year of mercy, receiving the mercy of God, and as we receive it, to give it away. Since it's a spiritual gift, and if you give it away, it gets bigger, unlike a piece of pie. Whatever it is the Filipinos are going to eat this year at Christmas, I mean, you give it away, and it gets less. But if you give away mercy, it's always wrong. Mercy. It's the words that John the Baptist's father uses when he sings out after his tongue is released, the glory of God in the appearance of his newborn son, whom the angel has told him has quite a providential future. But then again, we could say everybody has a providential future, but John is very specially chosen. In the Gospel tonight, which is the final Gospel, really, of the Advent season that we normally hear, it's the birth of John the Baptist. So we've heard, if you've been going to Simbang, Gabi every day, we've heard the Gospel of the Annunciation, of the Visitation of Mary and Elizabeth. Now we come to the birth of John the Baptist. His father was told that this was going to happen, even though his wife was beyond the age of childbearing, and it comes true. But because Zachary had his doubts, he is struck dumb. There are early thinkers in the church, fathers of the church, who say, that's a symbol that prophecy was speechless for a long time in Israel. And Zachary, the father, is struck dumb until the Baptist is born, and as soon as he's born, then he can speak. His tongue is loosed. There's no more mute presence of prophecy. Prophecy is fulfilled in John the Baptist coming on the scene. We also have to keep in mind, what's the big story of John's birth? His name, right? His name is the big topic, because the neighbors think they're going to call him Zechariah. But then his mother says, no, his name's going to be John. Now, you have to understand, what does the word John mean? John means, in Hebrew, the Lord gives grace. The Lord gives grace. It's a great name. It's a beautiful name. The Lord gives grace. Nobody in the family is called that. If you had troubles in the family over names, we won't get into that, right? But it does happen in some families. No, his name is John. And they even insist that the father write it out. Isn't that interesting? Like a scripture. The text is written out. And as soon as that happens, and they name him, then in fact, Zechariah can speak praise. John the Baptist is always pictured as he runs to prepare a way in front of the Lord Jesus at the Jordan. Have you ever also thought of John the Baptist as running behind Jesus to keep up, to follow him? There's two ways to look at John the Baptist, and both of them are equally important in our Advent celebrations. On the one level, he goes to prepare a way. Did you hear the first reading tonight from Malachi? Malachi says the messenger of the covenant's coming. He's going to purify. It's like the fuller's alkalizer. Sounds a little spooky. Who's ever coming? They're going to get people ready. And you need scour down clean because you're so bright. Elijah's coming. So it's... And when John the Baptist showed up, sisters and brothers, in some ways he was scary, wasn't he? You wouldn't want to meet him, right? You know, outside the church today. He would be a fearsome character in some ways. He runs to prepare a way, and he keeps saying, repent. And even at his birth, the family knows the Lord gives grace. St. Luke tells us that as he grew, he moved to the desert until the time was ready for him to announce, like Elijah, someone's coming. Someone is coming, greater than I. Do you notice that John the Baptist is very, very unpossessing of all the gifts that he had? Have you ever seen anyone like John the Baptist? When some of the people go out to him and they say, we're the sons of Abraham. You remember what John the Baptist said to them? He said, look, God can raise sons of Abraham from these stones. Who are you kidding? Huh? And then when the scribes and Pharisees came, John called them a brood of vipers. You never were allowed to call fellow Jewish people animal names. And he called them a brood of vipers. Listen, John wasn't trying to win friends and influence people, was he? John the Baptist was telling the truth. He's walking ahead, clearing the way, getting people ready by saying, don't you think that you possess God? Don't you think that you're possessed? Even I can't untie the sandal straps of the one who's coming. You can imagine people saying, ooh, wow, it's rough. The Lord gives grace. John never claims any merits. He keeps preaching repentance and justice. Repentance and justice. And then Jesus shows up, and John then follows Jesus. He has questions about him because he says, there's the Lamb of God. And a little later he says, are you the one coming? So even John is taken aback by Jesus. But he follows him. He follows him even to a martyr's death because he dared to tell King Herod, you shouldn't be married to your brother's wife. He's put in jail and later he's executed. John runs ahead. John imitates the Messiah and follows after. He's a beautiful Advent figure, sisters and brothers. Now we know that when you do Simbang, Gabi, The two people you're most interested in the last few days are Joseph and Mary, right? They're the ones like the Posada. You're marching with them to Bethlehem. That makes sense to me. So tonight you might say, well, isn't this strange? The last night of Advent, we're talking about John the Baptist. That's how the church's liturgy gets us, right? It kind of flips us a little. Says, wow. So we can ask one another, if God's mercy is pouring out and St. Luke's gospel is always interested in Jesus showing mercy, what do we do about John the Baptist? John the Baptist makes us aware that everything is grace. And even what we think is our own is a gift of grace, and we should never become overly vain and proud about it. It's very important, because if you do, then you'll lose the sense of mercy. The mercy God pours on all of us in His well-beloved Son. So tonight in Simbang, Gabi, the last one, first of all, we want to thank all of the members of the Filipino community, particularly when you bring your children to pass along a very revered and beautiful tradition of the faith. That's very important. Now I know in the Philippines they do it at 4 o'clock in the morning. I'm glad we don't do it at 4 o'clock. Even though that's probably the more important way to do it, you know, to do it in the morning. I think that's beautiful. But whether it's a morning or an evening, it is important that for the days before Christmas, that not only are our minds filled with the gifts we're going to get or give, but if our minds are filled in the journey search of Mary and Joseph, and in the background, John the Baptist, for the one who is to come, and who is here, and who is our whole life and our mercy. That's why this custom of Simbang Gabi is so important. It allows you to keep your head clear from being too fogged up with some aspects of our culture. Many aspects of our culture are beautiful. Some aspects of our culture are terrible. One of the aspects of our culture that's terrible is people get so wound up for the celebration of December 25th early that by the time you get to December 25th, you're exhausted. Right? Now, you shouldn't be exhausted. In the Catholic faith, I was with a group of Protestant ministers today, and they were saying, Mary, I said, shh, it's tomorrow. It's way tomorrow to say that. Let's just say Happy Advent. And you say, oh, I can't do that so much. Everybody says, you know, Merry Christmas. Okay, all right. We'll concede that. But we should at least say that in the second part of heaven when we say our Merry Christmas, don't get so overlaid with that you forget it's happened. And then Christmas makes more sense. That's why I like Simbang Gabi. It prepares the way. It's pushing us with Mary and Joseph, and I still think in the background John the Baptist, to prepare a fitting way for Jesus to come into our hearts even now. And the Lord gives grace. We don't own it. We bask in God's mercy. That's the beauty of getting ready for Christmas. And it's what the beautiful customs of Simbang Gabi show. Now, I don't read, you know, the language so well, whatever you're saying at the Gala, but even I could figure out on the Gloria Jesu Christo that that's Jesus Christ. So I know some of the words, and that's good. I know you're saying those kind of words, okay? It's beautiful. And I hope that you take some of the songs to heart, because to my mind, they are songs of yearning, getting ready. We're not there yet. We're almost there. We're getting ready. What does yearning mean? It means that it's not a possession that we can claim as our own. It's a gift of grace that allows us then to stretch out in mercy to others. Pope Francis is very insistent on this, that the Jubilee Year of Mercy is not a nice idea. It's an urgent reality. We need it. We need it personally in our encounter with Jesus. We need it as a church, and the world needs it too. If we look around the world, there is a great, great deal of violence. There is even violence against Christians in many parts of the world. The Simbang Gabi tradition, to my mind, helps us to realize that amidst all that, one way is to equal it with our own violence. Or we can walk humbly with Mary and Joseph and their procession to Bethlehem. So, sisters and brothers, particularly young people who are here, I'm glad you're here, and keep coming. Keep remembering this as you get older, that this custom and tradition is not just a lot of Filipino folklore. There's a theological reason behind this celebration, and it's important that it be kept alive. That means you've got to find ways in which you make it every year very interesting, very much a journey. Journey, like Mary and Joseph, to seek the mercy of the Lord. So thank you very much, and thank you, our priests who come out. This is usually a heavy time for confessions and whatnot. So I'm glad that you're here tonight. Thanks for all those who will be in here, and deacons. Thank you, sisters. I know some of the nuns are around. And even though I know everybody wants to say Merry Christmas, let's hold our breaths a little. It don't really make much better sense, right? When it's the day. God bless you and all that you do. God bless.